Yeah, thank you. Can you hear me back there? I kind of hate to ask that question because I did it once and everybody up front moved back. My name is John. I'm an alcoholic. Unlike Thelma, I was born on April 3rd, 1920, and for the younger generation that need a calculator, I'm 77. The next important thing that happened to me was on June 29th, 1970, or 1946, excuse me, I married Winnie. And she's here today, and if you don't have your calculator, again, we celebrated our 51st last, or we're celebrating our 50th last year, I am kind of different. I never had a sponsor. And I wondered how in the world, with all this, everybody speaking sponsors and raising so much hell about me not having a sponsor. And then all of a sudden I realized, hell, I've been sleeping with my sponsor for 50 years. So it worked out real good. And then my last drink was January of 1970. I don't know what the date in January was. People always want me, so I fixed up a deck of cards and took a card out, and it was the 11th. It was a jack of something, and it made me the 11th. So I used that as my date, the 11th of January, 1970. And then another most important date that I have to give you is 6/20/1997. Midnight last night, I had my 24th hour of sobriety again. So I think that's real important. Now, one thing about our marriage to Winnie, we never went to bed angry. We just stayed up and fought. But that worked out pretty good. I'm going to just run through this. You know that I've been sober for quite some time, and rather than go through a drunk log, I'll just tell you about kind of my history and give you an idea that no matter what, people can get sober under the AA program. Was raised on a cattle ranch in the east slope of the Rockies over in Montana. We lived so far from town that you had to go back toward town to hunt. A one-room schoolhouse. I went to school my first 7 years in this one-room schoolhouse. There was four or five families. One of them was a bootlegger. Prohibition was during that period of time. My father and mother never drank. It was a strange deal. There was drinking going on with this bootlegger all around us, but they never drank, and I never had any idea of it till I went to high school, and about my junior year, I was out working on my uncle's ranch. I guess I wasn't the junior year. I was about 13 or 14 when they outlawed probation and put the liquor came back in, and my uncle went to town and got some beer, and I had a taste of beer in 1933. Then it was about 4 years before I even started drinking again. I graduated from school, joined the National Guard, and wound up going overseas with I spent the next 5 years over in Australia and New Guinea. And just tell you a little bit about the two most horrible nights I've ever spent. Over there one night, I was an officer then. I started as a $21 a month private. We were inducted into the armed forces. A month later, I was a sergeant for some reason. I guess I was one of the tall guys in the outfit. And then they made me a mess sergeant because I had taken some bookkeeping in high school, and the mess was in the hole, so I had to pay. I had 43 cents a day per man to get the mess out of the hole, so I just fed beans and macaroni to these guys. It was an infantry outfit. That they liked that anyhow. The other guy was buying asparagus and such. And so I then was promoted to staff sergeant, and the guy came in and was a cook, so they took him and put me out, and I promoted again. And then I finally was commissioned down to Australia. And after one combat as an enlisted man, then went back to Australia, was commissioned, went back up in combat again. And one particularly bad night, I'll just tell this war story briefly. I was in charge of getting the communications, getting a man, and we down in the jungle, contact was about as far as that Corbin sign there from the Japanese. We just didn't know where anybody was. And we lost contact with a company to our right, so this kid and I went over to get a hold, to try and contact them. And as he stepped over a log, a booby trap or something, grenade, knee mortar, something like that, lit in front of him and knocked us both down, killed him. I crawled back and got back to camp, and my lieutenant had just been assigned to me a couple of weeks before, had been killed, and it was just a miserable thing. It went on all night. I was down on the ground and bullets were flying, and I thought, I'll never have as bad a day again in my life. If I live this through tonight, it's going to be great. Everything will be an upgrade. And some years later, probably right in just before my last drink, I remember laying in bed. My little boy was sleeping with me. Winnie and I had a horrible fight. She was sleeping in the other room, and I was just as frantic and as worried then. I had some checks out, and I was about to be fired, and I was just as bad that night as I was before. Those are the two most frightful nights I ever spent. And then, very shortly after that, things got so bad I got fired drinking. It was unfair because I had stopped drinking. I hadn't drank for 6 weeks, and I still got fired. Carried over. After I got fired, I wound up with a better job than I had before. You know, one of those things just lucked out. And then I was about into that job about 6 months and got picked up for drunk driving. And I was working for an insurance company. We wrote automobile insurance, and he had 100 agents, and they all knew I'd been picked up for drunk driving. It looked like I was going to be fired. I was gone. So the man that took me up to the AA club, my boss, and he said, have you got a problem? I said, well, obviously I got a problem. So he took me up the AA club up in the hill, and I thought, oh, damn it. See, I didn't use the S word. I said, oh, damn it. I've been up here and it didn't work. And I had been up there 10 years before. I bought a book and I went home and told Winnie, I said, things are going to be all fine now. I've got this book and I belong to this program. And she showed the book to a neighbor, and I thought the neighbors might think I was a drunk, so I went out and got drunk. And I didn't get back. For 10 years, I took a sabbatical. And I took Anabuse. And I would take that Anabuse, and I'd take a half a pill, and it'd last about 3 or 4 days. So I had it worked where I would take it when I was staying home. I'd take 2 pills, and it would work a week. And then if I was going out of town, I'd stop taking my Anabuse pill about on Thursday, and by Monday I could I could drink. So I'd I remember time after time driving down that Lewiston grade, all that crooked thing, with a beer in my hand, just sweating because with that antabuse working out of my system. And I did that for a long time. And then this finally, when I got picked up for the drunk driving, and I was going to be fired, the boss took me up to the club up there, and Ken up there, who just died this year, said, let me talk to an attorney. He got a hold of an attorney who knew an attorney down in Colfax, and a judge, and they gave me a right to, they told me that if I wouldn't drink for 6 months and would take a lie detector test, they would drop the charge, the drunk driving charge. And so then I went up to the AA club, and I said, I better do something about this. I better see if I can go there 6 months. And I went up there, and the first night that I really was sober and listening to the meeting, some of you know Lyle. Lyle got up with a marble. He said, the green is for puke, and the blood is, or the red is for blood, and I keep it in my pocket, and get this, that's what will happen to me if I ever drink again. And I thought, you know, it didn't sound very good to me. Then we had a fellow by the name of Ding-a-ling Dan that got up. And Ding-a-ling had been hit with a log up in a timber company, and he wasn't just really all there. And he was bragging about how good the program was, and he says, look at my wife. He says, look at, isn't she, you know, I wouldn't have her if I weren't sober. And she wasn't, she was a three after a six-pack of Old Taylor. And anyhow, I thought, what in the world am I doing here? And so then Jack Dunn, I can say Dunn now, he's done. Jack passed away last year. But a great, he was an Irishman, he'd been a salesman, everything that I was. But he got to talking about how the program had worked for him. He said, it worked so well that he says, I choose not to drink. He said, I'm happier this way. It was the first hope I ever had that I could stop drinking. Did you want something? Oh. Anyhow, I went to meeting every night. And I went to night after night. I went down to Lewiston and ran into Don Sly. I said, where's the meeting tonight? And he said, it's up in Lapway. I went up to Lapway, and it was a counselor and a Indian. The Indian was drunk, but they had some cookies, so he was there. And we had a meeting. I went back to Sly, and I said, geez, you really gave me a bad steer there. He said, did you get drunk? And I said, no. And he said, well, you went to a good meeting. And so they didn't give me much sympathy, you know, how it is. Anyhow, when it came time for me to go to this, up before this, for this lie detector test, about a week, 2 weeks before, I started thinking, I'm going to ask that person if I actually believe that I'm powerless over alcohol. And I thought about what I would ask him, how I would do the question, and how I would get it across so I could find out. So he strapped me in and we this, and he said, did you ever tell a lie? I said, sure. everybody does. He said, did you ever steal anything? And I said, well, yeah. Recently, I said, yeah, I made an expense account that couldn't stand too much scrutiny last week, in fact. And he said, this isn't working. He said, I've got to ask you a question so that you'll lie to me, and then I can get the blip, and then I can ask you the big question. So, and he went on to say, and you know, while he was asking me about lying and stealing and all this, I thought, hell, I'll take the fifth step. Here it is right now. I'll just give him everything he's got. So I was real rigorously honest with everything he asked me. So he finally said, here, he's got some cards out. And And he says, take out one of these, and when I ask you if it's that number, you say no. So he said, is it the 8 o'clubs? And I said, nope. And he said, yeah, we got the blip. And then he asked me if I drank. And so I never did really get to ask him if whether or not I had was powerless over alcohol. But I think just by working on my own mind, as tough as I did for that 2 weeks about that question I was going to ask him, I from there on, I've never had any doubt but what I'm powerless over alcohol. My life is so much better without it. And so anyhow, that is where I got involved in this the program, really to the hilt. And from there on, it's been great. I've got a higher power that when I first got up there, I heard the light bulb and the doorknob and belt buckle, spit tune, whatever you might have, is the higher power. And I thought, well, what the hell? I was born a Roman Catholic, so I'll kind of go along with that. And I realized that instead of a Roman Catholic, I was a roaming Catholic, you know. So I kind of got to thinking about it, and then I heard the people say, I'm a Reformed Catholic, or no, I'm a recovering Catholic, Reformed, recovering Lutheran, recovering Jew, or something like that. I realized that these people, that if they're bad enough to be on AA, they weren't good enough to be a very good church member in most cases. And so I said, well, good, I'll just take that. And so I do that. I've got kind of a half AA, half Roman Catholic belief now, and it works fine for me. I just love it. And I go to Mass. I don't sit there sweating with a hangover anymore or anything like that. It's get along fine. Let's see here, my thing else. I got a little something else here, and then I'm not quite through, I guess. I get my aunt abuse. Oh, you know, a lot of these people come up to you and they say, I'll just little tricks that I've learned in here. They say, you don't drink, do you? And I said, no. I said, did you ever drink? And they say, yeah, I drank a tank car full of that stuff, and I don't want to start on the second one. And so I said that. Then they say, do you belong to AA? And I said, are you asking me because you've got a drinking problem? And, they either back off, or if they say yes, I just reel them in, you know, take them to a meeting. And that works real good. So that works out fine for me. I heard the funniest thing about, I read a book here, this isn't original with me, but this fellow said, this woman said to him, says, you know, you're not very attractive when you're drinking. He says, I don't drink for me to be attractive, I drink to get you attractive. So, yeah. Okay. All right, here's a few things I've done in sobriety. I made a hole in one over at the country club in Missoula, golfing. It's kind of an unusual deal. And the funny part of that was I called Winnie and said, I have to stay out here for the guys a little while longer. And she said, you'd do anything to stay out with those guys. I took up downhill skiing when I was 50. My kids were skiing. I used to take them up on the hill, and I'd stay in the bar, and they'd ski, and got an AA, and would join it. I would ski in with them, and it was a better, easier drive home than before. I made my first parachute jump when I was 70. I always wanted to... I always wanted to do it. I always wanted to do that, shoot a goose, and get a degree. Well, I made the parachute jump. I had to tell Winnie a week before whether I was going to do it, and she spoke to me twice, both times about insurance. And then the other one about this, this is a little, another thing. When I was in, I came back and went to school under the GI Bill, and which was a great, great thing for all of us people at in that time. And I was sick. I was terribly sick with malaria. In fact, I got retired from the service because of, I was in the infantry, and I had both. I had malaria, combat fatigue, and flat feet. Anyhow, they retired me, and so I was. I then was able to go to school on the GI Bill, and during that time, I had to. My last year of school, I was going to law school. My last year in law school, I had a bad attack of malaria and wound up in the Veterans Hospital for a month. And in law school, you take classes for the whole year; you don't just take it for a quarter. And so I wound up with C's and D's, and I realized that I was probably very close to not making it. So I talked to someone, and they said, "Well, just get into business administration." So I said, "Okay, I'll do that." And I changed over. And when it came time to graduate, a recruiter came in from Minneapolis and got a hold of me and hired me, and went back to Minneapolis. And I went to graduate, and they said, "Doesn't fit. You just don't have the correct credits." So I said, "Fine." I took the job. And I stayed in that business for 35 years. And about in last year, my sister was having her 50th anniversary over at the University of Montana, where I went to school. And I got to know the alumni director, and he asked me when I graduated. And I said, "Well, I didn't." I gave him this little story, and he took a look, and I was 1.6 grade points short of a degree. So last fall, I went down to Gonzaga University and took a 2-credit course in the special aid department. And December 20th, I got my diploma. So I got 2 out of 3. And I love the geese flying over, and I'm never going to shoot them. So they're home free. It's okay. Now, just a couple of things. I've got 2 or 3 more minutes here. Things I dislike about the this AA program. I like everything about it, but I don't like these quite as much as the rest of it. I hate to have these people say to someone that's got a year or so, "Well, the second year is the hardest, or the fourth year is the hardest, the fifth year is the hardest." And I think that's a generality. I just don't like people talking like that. And they say AA marriages always end up in divorce. I don't know. Fred and I and Winnie and Les, we prove otherwise. We realize how much the program means to us. Then they say, "Never take even an aspirin," they tell these guys. You know, some of these people, well, geez, you get these people. I went out for 2 years to held a meeting out at Medical Lake, and the people there needed to take the medication. And we would tell them, when you get out, don't listen to those people. Take your medication and go to meetings, and you'll be all right. And I think that works. Bores at meeting. You know, you get these people who talk for 30 minutes and then leave the room or go to sleep or something like that. My solution there is when I'm running the meeting, and here's the bore here, I call this man and go around the room and never get to the bore. It works out real good. Well, I think that's pretty much what I've got to say. Oh yeah, then I kind of have no use for the people that sit around the half measure rooms and never go to meetings and that hit on the drunk women or men. I don't think that's AA to me. I'm not a great believer in profanity at meetings. One of my good friends, I made a little list, and every time he had one of those S's or F's or something like that, he had 51 in about a 5 minutes talk, and I showed it to him, and he hasn't done any of that since. He didn't realize what he was doing. And let's see. Oh, and the otherwise, rationalizing. We should all do that. I remember saying that I just couldn't stop drinking now because I had to drink champagne at my daughter's wedding, and she was 10. The other one I really like, rationalization, is I drink because it gives me the shakes and I need the exercise. The saying that is kind of proper that I kind of like is never cry over spilt milk. It could have been whiskey. Illusion, a reality is an illusion created by a shortage of alcohol. And then this guy was talking about this woman in this treatment center. He said she had a voice that would worm a dog. And my voice is given out. So I'll thank you very much for being attentive.